Once, in Mohartra, in the Rudy land of war, there lived a young woman by the name of Sabina, who possessed the gift of ubiquity. Whenever she wished, she was able to multiply herself and be at the same time, in body and in spirit, in as many places as she pleased. In the morning, for instance, when she was dressing, she doubled herself or tripled herself for the added convenience of studying her features or her figure in the mirror. Her examination ended, she would hurry to reassemble, that is, to melt back into one and the same person, and while in the rear, her husband, an assistant in the legal department of the FBNCA, suspected nothing and thought, of course, that he had, like everyone else in the world, an indivisible wife. One April evening, after dinner, and while in the rear was checking over some accounts at the dining room table, and Sabina, in an armchair, was reading a moving picture magazine. Lifting his eyes toward his wife, he was surprised at her position in the chair and the expression on her face. Her head was drooped on her shoulder, and she had let her magazine slip to the floor. Her eyes shone with a soft glow, her lips smiled, her whole face was resplendent with ineffable joy. Moved and marveling, Antoine tiptoed to her chair and leaned over devotedly, but she drew back with an impatient movement he could not understand. 8 days before, at the corner of the Avenue Nord, Sabina had run into a young fellow of about 25, with black eyes. He deliberately blocked her passing and said, "Ma'am." And Sabina, perching in the air and her eyes flashing, had said, "But monsieur." Barely a week later, she found herself, that April evening, at the same moment in her own home and at the young man's with the black eyes, whose real name was Theory and who pretended to be a painter. At the very moment she was shying away from her husband, sending him back to his accounts, Theory, in his studio in the Rue Chevalier de la Mairie, was holding the hands of a young woman and saying, "My heart, my limbs, my soul, and other pretty things which come easily to the lips of a lover in the first days of his tenderness." Each evening, Antoine Emirier marveled at the face of his wife, as it glowed in an expression of joy so wonderful that she seemed no longer to be of this earth. One day, when he was exchanging confidences with a colleague in his office, he let himself go so far as to say in a moment of emotion, "If you could only see my wife, when we sit up together in the evening in the dining room, you would think that she spoke with the angels." For 4 months, Sabina continued to speak with the angels. Her vacation that year was the most wonderful of her life. She was, at the same time, on a leave in Auburn with the Imperial and had a little beach in Brittany with Theory. "I have never seen you so beautiful," her husband told her. "Your eyes are like the lake at 7:30 in the morning." Meantime, on the sands of the little red beach, Sabina tanned herself in the sun with Theory, both about nearly naked. The young man with the black eyes said nothing, as yet sunk in a sentiment so profound that words could not express it. Actually it was, because he was already repeating over and over the same things. While the young wife marveled at the silence which seemed to conceal an inexpressible passion, Theory, none with animal happiness, waited tranquilly for meal times, reflecting with satisfaction that his vacation was not costing him a cent. Sabina, indeed, had sold some of her girlhood jewelry and had begged her companion to have the kindness to let the expenses of their stay in Brittany be her contribution. Somewhat astonished that she made so much of it thus to have him accept something one might take for granted, Theory accepted with the best grace in the world. It was his opinion that an artist ought in no case to kowtow to stupid conventions, and he less so than the others. "I do not recognize the right," he said, "of letting any scruples of mine stand in the way, if they should hinder me from achieving the work of an El Greco or an Alaskans." Living on a meager allowance from an uncle in Limoges, Theory did not count fully on painting to support him. A conception of art, faulty and inviolable, forbade him from painting, when he was not driven to it by inspiration. "If I have to wait 10 years for it," he said, "I'll wait." And that is about what he did. Generally, he worked at enriching his sensibilities in the beddings of Mohartra or refining his critical sense in watching his friends paint, and when they questioned him on his own painting, he had a reflective way of replying, "I am finding myself," which commanded respect. One morning on one of the last days of their vacation, the two lovers had just finished dressing in their room in the little red inn. 500 or 600 kilometers from there, in Auburn, the Imperials had already been up for 3 hours, and to her husband, who was rowing on the lake and praising the beauties of the sight, Sabina was responding, from further and further away, in monosyllables. But in the private bedroom she was sitting, as she looked out upon the sea, Theory took his wallet from the mantelpiece and before slipping it into his back pocket, he pulled out a photograph. In the photograph, Theory was in his winter outfit, and gazing at his sabots and the white velvet pants so prettily pinched in at the ankles, Sabina could well see how genius he was. She felt a twinge of remorse in her heart, for having given something from this dear boy who was not only such a tender lover but also such an artist. "I beloved, my sweet treasure, I have been hiding from you a secret. What are you talking about, my dear?" I am done and feeling felt his senses totter as well and evolved on his penis exactly alike. You were not angry, asked one of intimidated. Not at all, replied Feely. On the contrary, he smiled happily, as if he were grateful, and Sabina, reassured, kissed him in a transport of joy with all her nine mouths. At the beginning of October, about a month after their return from vacation, Ayme reared notice that his wife hardly spoke anymore with the angels. She seemed pensive and melancholy. At the same moment, Feely was pacing his studio and shouting, how do I know where you are this very minute? At the only in the art of self-seal man, or he purchased leaving with the shop, you swear to me.
Fearing, her neighbors were now so noisily amused they almost forgot.
wife, informing him nevertheless that she possessed nothing, not even a family name, only a given name, and that's the most ordinary, free, or Mary. Lord Gregory found this singularity most piquant. Without waiting for the finish of the last race, he left in a car with his fancy for the airport of La Borges. At 6 o'clock they arrived in London, and at 7 they were there. While she was being married in London, Sabina was dining in the room dealing with her opposites for her husband and Juan Lemurier. He found her looking much better, and he spoke to her with approving kindness. Touched at his solicitude, she suffered a twinge of conscience, and asked herself if she could espouse Lord Gregory without contravening human and divine laws. It was a thorny question which involved another, that of the consubstantiality of the spouse of Antoine and that of the spouse of Lord Gregory. Even if each of her were an autonomous physical person, the fact remained that marriage, if it is consummated in the mortal flesh, is first of all a union of souls. In fact, her qualms were excessive. The legislation of marriage having failed to consider the case of ubiquity, Sabina was afraid to act according to her own will and might even, in all good faith, believe herself in order with heaven, since there was no form, brief, restrict, or yet which had never specifically touched upon the problem. Still, she had too high a sense of conscience to take advantage of such lawyer's reasons. Furthermore, she believed in a duty to consider her marriage with Lord Gregory as a consequence of and a prolongation of adultery, which justified itself in no way and was, of course, perfectly damnable. In amends to God, to society, and to her husband, since she had thus offended all three, she forbade herself ever to see the ring again. It must be said, the beginnings of her life in England rendered Sabina's remorse and even the pain of absence supportable. Lord Gregory was truly a remarkable person. Besides being extremely rich, he was a descendant in direct line from King Sam Sarah or John Lackland, who had contracted a morganatic marriage with her resident Dietrich Keppel, a circumstance little known to historians, and Ayme had 17 children, all dead at an early age, with the exception of the 14th, Richard Hughes, founder of the House of Gregory. His marriage with Sabina was quite an event. The new lady was the object of well-wishing curiosity, although her sister-in-law tried to circulate a rumor that she was formerly a dancer at now tabloid. Sabina, who in England was called Marie, was very much taken up with her obligations as a great lady. Receptions, teas, living for charity, golf, things, never permitted a moment to dine in. Still, all her various occupations did not make her forget the earring. The painter had no doubt as to the source of the checks which he received regularly from England, and he accommodated himself perfectly to not seeing Sabina anymore in his studio. Delivered from his material concerns by the monthly allowances which had risen to some hundreds of thousand francs, he recognized that he was going through a period of hypersensibility little conducive to the accomplishment of his work, and what he needed was, so to say, to decant himself. Consequently, he allowed himself a year for rest, more if it appeared to him he might need it. One saw him less and less as for martyr. He decanted himself in the bars of Montparnasse, where he lived on caviar and champagne with expensive girls. Having learned that he was leading a rather disordered life, Sabina, for her work intact, imagined he was following some Goya-esque formula for art, blending the play of light with the immodest sufficiencies of a female mask. One afternoon, after returning from 3 weeks at Gregory Castle, Lady Gregory interrupted her sumptuous residence on Mountain Square, found 4 boxes containing, respectively, a silk dress, an afternoon gown in Roman crepe, a woolen sports dress, and a classic tailor-made in sparadrap. Having dismissed her chambermaid, she multiplied by 5 in order to try on all the dresses at once. Inadvertently, Lord Gregory walked in. My dear, he cried, what four ravishing sisters you have, and you never told me anything about them. Instead of reassembling, Lady Gregory was confused and felt obliged to say, they just arrived. Alphonsine is my elder, my dear. Bridget is my twin sister. Barbara and Rosalie are my 2 younger sisters, also twins. People say they resemble me a lot. The 4 sisters were well received in high society and faded everywhere. Alphonsine married a millionaire American, a pick of stamp leather, and crossed the Atlantic with him. Bridget married the Maharaja of the Isidore, who took her to his princely residence. Barbara married an illustrious Neapolitan tenor, whom she accompanied on his world tours. Rosalie Wednesday, a Spanish explorer, who took her with him to New Guinea to study the curious customs of the Papuans. These 4 marriages, which were celebrated almost simultaneously, made a stir in England and even on the continent. In Paris, the newspaper accounts were accompanied by pictures. One evening, in the tiny room in the Rue de la Concorde, Antoine Lemurier said to Sabina, you've seen the photos of Lady Gregory and her 4 sisters. It's astonishing how much they look like you, except that you have lighter eyes, a more elongated face, a smaller mouth, a shorter nose, and not so strong a chin. Tomorrow night, I'm going to take the newspaper and your photograph to show to Miss Marquardt. He'll never get over it. Theory, informed by the newspapers on these nuptial festivities, had not the slightest doubt when he saw the photograph. This time he felt the need to go back to Mahartra. He had not changed anything in his way of living, and it was not long before he was making a reputation as an octambulous roisterer, good drinker, and go anywhere, do anything fellow. So he learned of the imam's back and up and realized he was making a fatal misstep. Her faith in him and his destiny was shaken, but she loved him all the more tenderly for it and blamed herself for being the cause of his downfall. For nearly a week she wrung her hands in all four corners of the world. One night, when she was coming back from the movies in company with her husband, Sabina saw Theoring standing between the arms of three hilarious girls. Intoxicated, Theoring was losing all the wine he had drunk and at the same time delivering himself of disgraceful insults directed at the two creatures with him, one of whom was holding his hand and familiarly addressing him as her pig, while the other, in army terms, was raiding his resources in love. Having recognized Sabina, Theoring turned his fear face toward her, took out the name of Hungary, followed by brief but revolting commentary, and then sent in a heap at the foot of a lamppost. From the date of that encounter, sadness, and he was astounding himself at not having had his revelation sooner. It was not hard to prove his madness. If the grand vacation and the ubiquity of Samita had never had any reality other than in his mind, the whole thing was certainly the illusion of a man. On the other hand, supposing everything were true, feeling one in the position of a man who was witness to an answer the truth, one fit only for a mental patient. The certitude of his dementia affected the painter deeply. He became somber, withdrawn, suspicious, avoiding his friends and discouraging their advances.
I'm a jack of spades.
saw the gorilla go into a Lee's Magnum's place, they could not help intoning a canticle of joy. Now and then God himself glanced down, but he was far from sharing the enthusiasm of the angels. He rebuked them, paternally. Now then, he said, that's just one soul like any other. I realize that the contest is quite spectacular, but what you are seeing there is only what takes place in all poor souls to whom I have not taken the trouble to give 56,000 bodies.